It's part two of our series, Upcoming Artists That We Love. And today it's Chicago's Jenny King. I'm John Beaudin from Rocky Stream Music. I say it's part two because the first one was Amanda Dean on our Canadian channel. Both ladies I met through loving Toto and interviewing Toto. And of course, having a band of cats that can play at that level, you know some of their fans are going to be great musicians as well. The day I heard her sing, I went, what? She was a paramedic for 20 years in Chicago. She's a nurse now. And she just battled COVID-19 herself. She's recovering. She's doing okay.
How old were you when you knew you could sing at that level? Was it all your life?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, it was about three. I started singing with my grandmother, actually. She was a singer. And we just would sing along to her records. And then she taught me how to harmonize. And it just went from there. And then I was always singing.
In high school, were you that girl?
I was. I actually was I was a music major and art major. I had two majors in high school. The high school I went to was a performing arts high school. And we had majors in our high school to prepare us for careers in the arts. So I did fine art and music.
So you're like the fame girl. You're like the fame girl.
You know what? It was like fame. It really was. My high school was exactly like fame. I'm not kidding. People dancing and singing in the hallways. It was crazy, crazy.
I want to live forever.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. When I was 18, I went to the fire department, and people always say, what kind of segue was that from art and music into...
Why'd you do it? Why?
You know, actually what prompted that was just sort of kind of a twist of fate in life. I had a high school sweetheart all throughout high school, and we were, you know, kind of secretly engaged, you know, that those kind of things when you're young and in love and, you know, first love type thing. We were going to get married. Unfortunately, he died in an accident shortly after high school. So that actually prompted me to become a firefighter and a paramedic. I actually had a discussion with the paramedics that were on his call. And I wanted to find out. I wasn't with him when it happened. So I wanted to find out what exactly happened. And I tracked down the crew and everything. They were in Chicago, really great guys. And that sort of just prompted me to really want to do something I felt with tremendous purpose. And that's it. And the rest is history.
Wow. But didn't you find it healing though? I mean, it's a healing thing to...
It was.
To find, well, what changes our mind? The information.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. It was healing. And music and art was something I still always did on the side, but I certainly couldn't give it the full attention that I wanted to, just because of my schedule. It's like I told you, only the lonely can play. So hold on, here we go. Hold on to nothing we know. A nurse. I still do nursing. I love being a nurse. And I still do music and I still do art. I'm not quitting any of it.
Paul McCartney said years ago, he said, you know, the Beatles were, he always says the Beatles were a good little band. It's funny when he says that.
Don't you love that?
Yeah, it's cute. But he said that the greatest bands in the world and the greatest singers were never discovered because someone got pregnant. Dad died. He needed to go work on the farm.
Yeah.
There's too many distractions and things in the way. With the amount of talent I see from you, and that's why we're talking, not just because I think you're a really nice person, but I really think you're amazing. But what was it that didn't make you take that plunge or move to LA or?
Oh, gosh. I think probably a lot of it was, again, I thought, oh, well, I don't have time for that, or oh, how could I possibly do that? I have a great job, I have stable income, I'm helping people, I'm doing a lot, I have, really built some roots here in Chicago. I felt like, it would just be so disruptive to my life at that point. And probably a little bit was just fear. I'm sure. I just was scared and thought, no, there's no way I could do that. That sounds crazy, right? I'm not afraid to run in a burning building, but I'm afraid to go. Right? It's I know. But I'm afraid to go to LA and like try out, to really, try to do it. But I just didn't. I think it was just a different point in my life. And I made the decision to stay in the career that I stayed in for quite a while. I don't regret it. But now I'm able to do a lot of the things I wanted to do in music, which is fantastic.
So you become a paramedic. Were you, how often were you gigging back then, or did you let it rest for a while? What did you do?
Gosh, yeah, very rarely. It was really sporadic because really it was when I could have time. And I kind of was just didn't really have one main band. I was kind of just going around singing with sort of guest singing with other people. I got a chance, to get up there with Buddy Guy. That was so great. Coco Taylor. Yeah, and I was really, really young when I did that, so I was really scared. It was a place called Cordon Blues in St. Charles, and it was such a great little blues joint in St. Charles, which I was so surprised with, because I grew up in the city, which had many wonderful blues places, and I thought, oh, there's not gonna be any good blues places out in the suburbs, and there it was. And I did. I got up on stage with her, and that was just fantastic. One of the best moments. She was amazing. Buddy Guy was actually I was introduced to Buddy through another friend of mine who used to build all of his guitar amps, custom built. Yeah, I'm still really good friends with him, actually. His name's Dan Butler. Great guy, and builds all of Buddy's amps. So when you see those Chicago Blues Box amps, those are my friend's amps that he builds. I think Eric Clapton and I think Jimmy Vaughn may have a couple of those as well. That's how I got to meet Buddy. And of course my friend Dan was, oh, you gotta hear her sing, you gotta hear her sing. I was, I was like, oh no, don't.
I see my folks in the getting old, and I watch their bodies change. I know they see the same in me, it makes us both feel strange. No matter how you tell yourself, it's what we all go through. Those eyes are pretty hard to take, yeah, when they're staring back. Scared to run out of time.
I always spending my allowance on records and cassettes and albums. That's how old I am. I still say albums. I don't say CDs.
What were the early ones for you?
Well, I was always very influenced. First of all, and it's funny because the Toto connection, but Toto was one of the first bands I was listening to as. Really, I mean, I was 7 years old listening to Toto. And I know a lot of people think, well, yeah, that's odd. You know, and most 7-year-olds aren't listening to Toto. But my dad was a musician, and he toured with many famous artists. And, you know, he was really influential in that process. So he would kind of sit down with me and say, I want you to listen to this. And it's funny because he would say, I want you to listen to whoever he would have for the day. And Toto was one of them. As a matter of fact, it was Hydra was the album. I remember this very clearly. And he said, these are the best, most talented cats you're ever going to hear. Cats. He called them cats. Which is cute. Yeah. And you know what? I was blown away. And I really appreciated great music at a young age. There was Pink Floyd. There was a bunch of stuff, but not just classic rock. There was jazz. There was blues. A lot of different genres in our house. And there was always music. Everyone played an instrument, at least one, yeah, in our family.
Did you do the talent show things like in high school and stuff like that?
I did. I did. I know it sounds so cheesy, but I did.
I don't think so.
I mean, not a lot, but yeah. I did do a few of them. I danced as well. So there was a lot of dance, you know, dance shows, plays, a lot of musicals, your typical Grease, you know, things like things like your typical high school.
Tell me more. Tell me more.
Yeah. Tell me more. Yeah. Right.
And
I was originally from the East Coast. So
Where are you from?
New Jersey. New Jersey. And we moved to Chicago. So, like, when I was a kid, I still sort of had that, a little bit of an accent. Yeah. And it was so funny because I guess it would come out at certain times and people go, oh, yeah, I hear it a little bit. And so when I got into the play, of course, that was perfect. It was tell me more, tell me more. Yeah. It was, yeah.
The Toto guys, you've met them, right? Have you met them?
Yes, yes. A few times. They're great. Oh, my gosh. So nice. So down to earth. So cool. And it literally, I've seen so many people get up on stage with them. They're wonderful. Yeah, sure, come on up. Come on up and play. I mean, it's like, what?
They're accessible, yeah.
Yeah, very. And I actually got to meet them through my friend Jovanna, who is with Mecca. Mecca is made up of some of the members, past members of Toto.
David.
And also Shannon's done a lot of work too with Mecca. And so that's how I met all the guys. Jovanna actually contacted me. He was looking for a female vocalist for some studio work that he was doing. And a friend of mine said, you know, hey, why don't you contact Jenny King? Mm. And I just thought, oh my goodness, thank you so much. Cause Joe is an amazing singer, songwriter, incredible, just incredible. So I felt really honored that Joe would reach out to me. And so when that happened, we started talking about Toto, of course, cause everything comes back to Toto. And he said, oh, yeah, I've been friends with those guys for years. I did a lot of work with them. You know, come on over. We'll go out to lunch with them. And I was, what? You know, Steve Lukather's been probably, I would say, my all-time favorite musician, really, for years. And I thought it was so surreal that there I was sitting at a table having lunch with him. I just was like, what? This can't be happening. Yeah. And so sweet. So down to earth.
Oh my God.
And he's so funny.
Yeah.
I mean, I was probably laughing the whole lunch. The whole thing's a blur. It was just still, you know, Steve, look at there. He's right here.
Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I've traveled the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something. Ooh,
incredible songwriter. And I just, you know, we've had a few sessions where we sat down and kind of talked about some of the things that I've written. He would like for me to do at least cut an EP or maybe a single of my own. I would like to do that. I mean, it's kind of a nice thing, but I'm still a little like, I'm not sure. I think he'll probably get me to do it maybe next year. I think that'll be coming. But, you know, putting like your song out there, it's like, here's my soul. Here you go. You know,
that's a deep diary. It's a deep diary song.
It is. It is. It really is. So I've always been a little bit of, you know, kind of a chicken with that. I am. I'm a wuss.
So who's your dad and who did he play with?
Well, my dad, you know, he's my stepdad, but he's been my dad forever, since I was little. And so, you know, I call him my dad. His name's Mike Siebold. He used to play in a band called, this is great, you can look them up. I'll send you a link.
Okay.
Called Leslie's Motel. And Leslie's Motel was, very heavily influenced by Mountain. As a matter of fact, my dad's cousin was Felix Popularity. And Felix Popularity was the bass player for Mountain and the producer for Cream. Yeah, that Felix. Felix died a long time ago. That's my dad's cousin. So we kind of have that little connection there in the family. So my dad picked up a guitar when he was about eight or nine, and kind of self-taught, again, just started playing one of those, and then just continued, and he was just phenomenal. He just had a natural talent for that. So his band went on tour with, oh my goodness, many people, Allman Brothers, Mountain, John Lee Hooker. They played a lot with John Lee Hooker as well. And I mean, there was a lot. Santana, they really did a lot of work with a lot of great, phenomenal bands. So that's where kind of, I think that, you know, my dad was always kind of encouraging, yes, you know, do music, it's great. But he was also a business guy too. So it's funny, like we kind of both have that same thing where, what I used to joke, I still do, where it's, you know, business by day, party by night.
Yeah.
With the dual stuff.
Well, funny, you're the broken one, but I'm the only one who needed saving. Cause when you never see the light, it's hard to know which one of us is caving. Not really sure how to feel about it. Something in the way you move makes me feel like I can't live without you. It takes me all the way. I want you to stay.
What a voice, huh? Jenny King is one of those people. Walks into the room and there's entertainment right there. She's just amazing. What a voice. We're going to start doing more of these new artists, or in her case, up-and-coming artists. She's got a real name for herself in Chicago. Hopefully that'll segue into her releasing some great music. She's more than capable of doing that. Thanks, Jenny. We appreciate it. If you know someone we should feature, let us know in the comments for this video. So make sure you comment. We read them every single day. Subscribe to our channel and share our videos on social media, and buy a t-shirt. Help support our channel. I'm John Beaudin from Rock History Music.